solving task number one and task number two. Just again, task number one is actually the result of knowledge that you collect. By the way, can you read it? Yeah? Okay. Sorry for the small characters, but there's only so many pixels on the screen, right? And I need to give you the whole picture at the moment. So task number one is based on people, knowledge, and behavior, and needs people have, for which you need techniques. And it's based on the practice of work in an organization. So, and you could find out by going there, by doing ethnography, go to the office of your client, find out what's going on. This is talking to your client, maybe. This is finding out what's going on. And this is documents and artifacts. Ask your client. I told both clients that they should be able to hand out to some things they have written down. Actually, both of them already prepared PowerPoints as well. Try to get a copy of them, right? So get documents. And all of this helps you to develop a task model. A model of an existing situation. The people can talk about it. Actually, maybe even the customers of the client who talk about it. Or potential customers of the client. If your client is about automotive, there might be other people that you happen to know who ride cars and are passionate about. And if the client is about a new system for televisions, you might know people who are fond of their television set and like to do new things with them, right? So you could find potential customers already to talk about. Because cars and televisions are around, it's not new. So you can find out what people think. And there's artifacts and documents, and you could find them. And so you could develop a task for one. And actually, end of the afternoon, you should start getting the stuff, and tomorrow morning we speak about it, and you are going to build it. Now, from task model one, there's definitely problems and things that could be better. And then you have a client who wants things. Your client will already tonight tell you things that he or she wants to accomplish. I would like my television services to be different in this way, right? So task model two is based on what your client is asking you, but also what you find from your own task analysis, right? You find your own task analysis, things that could be better, things that people say, if only it would work like this, and you'll find, and then there's the technology. So find out about the opportunity. And maybe find out about things that need to be available that are not yet, or things that your client should find out before their wishes would come through. So this is task number one, task number two. And task number two, once again, there are ways to evaluate already early on by drawing a picture of it that you could show to people, right? If you make a scenario of your task model, you could show the scenario to users and say, would you be happy if your television would in future behave like this? And then you are already evaluating your task model without having any details on the technology. Okay, last chapter for today. That could work. Task number one in detail, collecting task knowledge. Right. Bridget Jordan. I know her quite well. I met her actually in 1996, and then I copied this from her. And by the way, there is, in the learning environment, a pointer to her library. So she makes all her publications publicly available at her website, which is nice. Bridget Jordan is an ethnographer. Meaning literally, when she was young, she went to Mexico, where there are locations in Mexico where there are still American Indian tribes living more or less as they lived hundreds of years ago. And she was studying in this Indian tribe how medical knowledge got transferred. So how people had some kind of ideas about what good medical knowledge was, how it would be transferred to other people. And in order to do that, as an ethnographer, she was allowed to be an apprentice midwife. So this means she would assist an older lady, when ladies give birth to a child, she would assist in giving birth. And as an ethnographer, she was allowed to be an apprentice. And so this is how she actually learned to be an ethnographer. and later on she was back in the US, and she did the same type of things for improving air traffic control systems. So being around in the air traffic control room where people were working to guide planes from one part of the air corridor to another part of the air corridor, and she could be an apprentice to find out what was going on in order to redesign, to improve air traffic control. So an ethnographer can be an ethnographer somewhere in a very far away culture and society, or in a very technical session. And she did both. And she has published a lot, even about giving birth to people from her Mexican period, and about air traffic control, and about how to perform ethnography. So what I'm telling you about ethnography, I learned from Britain. And I'm very happy about that, because there's lots of literature about ethnography, and there's a very small amount of knowledge how to do it. And Bridget just learned how to write. And she tells me two things. She tells me part of the knowledge, because it's all about knowledge, right? Task analysis is about knowledge. Getting task analysis is about getting the knowledge, collecting the knowledge. And she tells me there's knowledge that's in the person, in the individual people, and there's knowledge that's in the society, in the group, around, right? And so she tells me it makes a difference whether you are looking at knowledge that's here, in my head or in your head, and knowledge that's on the walls, so to speak. There's lots of knowledge here on the walls, right? And she says, well, and there is knowledge that's explicit, knowledge that people can speak about or that you can read, because it's on the walls. And there's knowledge that people don't speak about, but they still know. So this is the implicit knowledge. Yeah? Individual, group, explicit, implicit. And so if you are searching for knowledge, you should always find out, did I get it all? If you only ask the experts, you might get this one. If you never ask experts, but look around, make pictures, do graphic stuff, you get this one. If you only ask what people know, you get the top one. But if you try to understand what's going on and what people are not able to speak about, you get this one. So try to collect it. Four quadrants, well, obviously there is a lot of knowledge in between, right? Bridget and I with her, we are kind of making it simple, but if you consider this, you get much. So explicit knowledge is facts. You can ask people, how do you do it? You can ask people, what's the best way to do it? And you can ask people, how did you learn it and show it to them, right? And this is implicit. So if you ask a guy in Amsterdam how he rides a bike and never drops off the bike, he will probably not be able to tell you this. But he can show it. Right? And there's many things people are able to do, but we call it expertise, or we call it intuition or common sense, but it could be very complex. I know medical doctors, sometimes they need, in certain parts of the medical profession, they need to interpret very complex graphical structures, like things that's going on in the brain, or very complex signals of the human heart beating. And if they are real experts, they learn after maybe 4 or 5 years, they learn how to interpret, and they cannot explain to others. And if you want to learn, you have to walk with the experts for a couple of years, and at a certain moment you start to understand. This is expertise, but nobody is able to speak about it. Right? So, just walk with the expert and try to understand, and at a certain moment say, oh, wait a moment, I think it's this. And then the expert says, yes, you are now in the right way. So, and the same is here. So, explicit group knowledge is knowledge that's there. So, it says a couple of things on the door about when you are leaving the room. And maybe you don't know what it says, but you know, if I leave the room and I'm the last one, I should look at the door, and then I know what to do. Actually, it says you should switch off the beamer and you should leave the room as it's found. Well, hopefully I know how I found it. Anyhow, and go to elevators. At elevators, there's very interesting stories about what to do in case of fire, right? It's always by law, I think. So it's explicit group knowledge. So everybody says, just go there and you can read it. And nobody can tell you what you can read because we never memorize, because we know it's there. Right? So how does the copy machine work? Well, there's a printer.